Hello and welcome to our fourth webinar in the series Adapt, Evolve and Succeed in the New Normal. Thank you, dear audience, for your participation. This webinar series is arranged by ISBNM Kolkata for all the people out there, the students, faculties and the greater community. Today, our topic is VUCA is the New Normal. VUCA, the acronym that stands for volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. This acronym gained popularity in the late 80s, especially in the military circuit, to talk about challenges during Iraq War. But more and more, this acronym is now used to describe challenges of managerial leadership. We have with us Mr. Shubhato Haldar, an accomplished professional with over three decades of experience. He brings into the table a unique blend wherein he has worked with not only the sales and marketing domain, but also human capital development. Having worked in key leadership roles across industry verticals, his current area of interest is the future of work and workspaces, which brings us to VUCA. Thank you, Mr. Haldar. It's great to have you here with us.
My pleasure.
My first question would be, according to Yuval Noah Harari, very popular and a very important thinker of our time, this uncertainty is, what he means is we should stop thinking of uncertainty as a disruption. We would rather have to accept that being normal. We have to normalize it. And our focus should be to upskill and reskill ourselves constantly so that we can stay relevant. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, thank you very much, Virupa, and a very good morning to everybody who is logged in. To answer your question, Virupa, I can't agree more. The fact that it's a VUCA world, as you mentioned, the fact that disruption is the order of the day, and just not because of this pandemic and COVID, it's been there for quite a while now, for what we call Industrial Revolution 4, and which I shall mention maybe during the session. It is but a given. And therefore, what I would, in trying to answer your question, or rather address your question, let me in fact dive, because you've given me a lovely cue, let me dive deep into my presentation to begin with, because I think the answers are in situ in that, are inbuilt into that. And maybe with the course of my conversation and discussions and during our interaction, this will get answered. Would that be okay?
Perfect. Let me tell our audience that we also have with us, chairing as a co-host, Professor Brita Singh, a communication expert working with ISBNM Kolkata for over a decade now. And dear audience, I would request you to please listen to the webinar and, more importantly, raise your relevant questions, because we will be answering your question online. So we are hooked to you and we are looking forward to your participation and your questions. Please tune in and please be alert while Mr. Haldar takes us through VUCA. Please key in your questions right now in ISBNM Kolkata Facebook page.
Thank you very much, let's start. I just want to check with you, Virupa, is this visible? Virupa, is this visible?
Yes, it's perfectly visible.
Fine. Okay, thank you very much. Virupa, you have asked a question, so let me, in trying to answer that, let me take a step back and mention that the session title that I had discussed and agreed is that VUCA is the new normal. Now, why am I saying that get ready for a roller coaster? It's exactly what your question was indicating. VUCA, as we mentioned, is a volatile, uncertain, it's a complex and ambiguous world out there. Let's not mistake that. And that is the new reality. That is the new normal. Why is it so? Let's explore. And because it is very volatile, because the ecosystem is uncertain and complex and ambiguous, nobody really knows what's going to happen. It's going to be a hell of a roller coaster ride for all of us, for those who are getting ready for a corporate life going forward over the next three decades. It's going to be a very, very different world. Is that something we need to be worried about? I'm not too sure. Should we plan for it? 100% yes. It will not be the way we have understood the ecosystem to be so far. So it will be a different ecosystem. Am I claiming that I'm an expert in understanding that ecosystem inside out? Far from it. That's my caveat. I'll start with that caveat, a disclaimer. The disclaimer is that I do not think that I'm a one and only expert. In fact, I would go to the extent of saying I suspect that there are very few of us in the ecosystem today who exactly can say this is how the landscape should look like over the next decade plus. What we can, however, do is using our past experience and understanding and some indicative empirical data that's emerging and the trends that are visible as to we can make a reasonable guess as to what it might look like. Now, before we get in, I wanted to clear certain or establish certain home truths about the ecosystem. Home truths as in things that are given. You can't kind of, you know, debate this anymore, whether we like it or not, it's there. And some of them are that please understand past is history. The way we were, professional life, personal life, it's gone. To a large extent, if not to an entire extent. And yesterday's rules will not, perhaps may not. And yesterday's rules may not work anymore. Also, and this is important, you know, the jigsaw puzzle has all its pieces in different. If you see the picture on the left-hand side, it's a whole goddamn mess of wires with different colors, etc. If I ask any one of us, including me, to make sense out of this mess, ask one of us to kind of, you know, untangle it and reconnect it to the right wires at the right points, it will be a hell of a ask. Perhaps pretty much extremely difficult to do, and that is exactly what the scenario is. Remember, in our childhood, we were often given a jigsaw pieces to put in place, but in that we had an advantage. We had a reference picture given along with it, with which we were supposed to match and put the jigsaw pieces. It could be a picture of a dragon, an elephant, a lion, or whatever it is. And the jigsaw pieces were supposed to be put in place by us. As a child, we often did that. But here, the point is, and the significant point is, that there is no reference pick to solve the puzzle. We have a jigsaw puzzle. We don't know what the ecosystem is kind of navigating itself as, how the ecosystem is playing out. So it's a jigsaw puzzle. And we are supposed to navigate, survive, do well in that ecosystem. And yet, there is no reference pick to solve, because there is no reference marker as to how that ecosystem is supposed to look and how am I supposed to perform in that ecosystem. There is no reference pick. So it's a jigsaw puzzle we are supposed to solve without a reference pick. And therefore, I call it one blind man leading the other. That's exactly the truth. None of us are expert, none of us know exactly, but that's the reality. However, one can make some reasonably assumptive conclusions based on data and information and try and navigate as best as we can. Therefore, in all this scenario, this is the context, this is the home truth. The critical question is, and Obirupa, your question was, therefore, and I call it, what is the way forward? The famous Hollywood movie long, long back came, it was by this name called Quo Vadis, and but here I am using this slide to kind of therefore ask this question to all of us, that what is therefore the way forward? What is the right way? And do we really know what is the right way? Therefore, you know, in a business context, you have to understand, in a business ecosystem, there are two very critical stakeholders. One of them is the consumer. The second is, of course, the business, which is serving that consumer. And in the third pillar, I have said, what is the ask? Ask here means, what is it that the business will ask from you and I, today's and tomorrow's corporate citizens, to, or would be required from us by the business, to be able to successfully take our career forward and address what the consumer would want or probably would look at over the next few years and decades, both because of COVID and the reasons beyond COVID, which we shall discuss. Let's look at the consumer. What is it, because of this COVID and because of the pandemic, which has only accelerated the VUCA scenario, what is it that the consumer is likely to be like today and for the next few, maybe couple of years from now? See, today, because of COVID and otherwise, and because of the economic system that we have, or the challenge that the economy is facing, people are unsure about their own earning stability, even if they earn, whether they'll earn as much, whether they'll earn regularly, whether the job is there, not there tomorrow, there is uncertainty. So he's unsure, the consumer is unsure about his earning stability. Consequently, chances are, these are not finite statements, these are probabilities, chances are that he's likely to spend less. So tomorrow, if for example, till today he was or she was spending 100 rupees in a given day, tomorrow he or she might spend 50, figure as an example, and in that 50 also, things will get priority. Something which is non-essential, which is good to have, but not necessary to survive, might take a backseat in terms of my spend priority. So essential items will get priority. Lifestyle products and service might get lower spends. In most cases, I'm not saying everybody will do it, but in many cases, lifestyle products and services might get a lower spend. I will spend less on those things because they are not essential to my survival. Somebody who is smoking a triple pipe cigarette, to give an example, might come down to a cigarette brand of a lesser cost and so on. Therefore, there is an overall a sentiment of uncertainty more because now of COVID and therefore the economy being what it is, etc. Essentially, therefore, people might start saving more and spending less. These are expected. If it doesn't happen, brilliant, all the better for us. But this is likely to be the scenario from a consumer perspective, by and large. Therefore, what is it that it means for the business? What does the business face because of this? Now, the business, if you look at the business, if all this happens from the consumer side, the business will obviously have less revenue because they will sell less, do less business. If there is less revenue, the business will obviously be under cost pressure, because they will have to manage with lesser cost. They are doing lesser revenue. They were doing 100 rupees of revenue yesterday. Today, if that revenue figure has come down to, say, 70, whatever number, because of these lesser spends by consumers, then they have to also proportionally adjust their costs so that they're able to survive as a business, because ultimately they are business. They have to survive. They can't shut down. Because if they do shut down, then that's added pressure to the economy. So there will be cost pressure for the business. They might, and I'm not sure of this, but they might have enough, they might not get enough credit to do their business as well, especially the SME and MSME sectors, who account for a large part of our economy. I'm sure the government of the day is doing enough to step in and provide as much liquidity to the market, as much credit to the market as possible. But then again, is that enough is the critical question. And all in all, for the business, it's a VUCA ecosystem, because there is volatility, there is uncertainty, complexity, ambiguity. So there is a lot of dynamism, essentially, that's happening. And therefore, when business looks at these conditions of less revenue, cost pressure, etc., what does it need from you and I, who are employees there? Or what is it that they expect their employees to do for them as a business? I think, and this may look like a little generic in its terminology, but I'll just stay with me for a minute. I think what is required, apart from your skills and qualifications that you might come with, I think there is a critical need for clarity of thought. Now, what I mean by clarity of thought, I'll just explain. Just bear with me by 2 minutes. And somebody who has the skill to navigate without the stars being there. Now, if you remember, we have told stories, I'm sure they're here, 400-500 years back, when the sailors used to sail the high seas. Those days they didn't have the modern equipments and on their ships. And so they often used to look at the night stars or the morning sun, etc., and set their direction and decide what is the right direction to move towards. The compass probably was not even there at that time, even the compass. Now today, because of this VUCA ecosystem, it's a problem because we don't have that reference picture in the jigsaw puzzle. We don't really know what is it that the direction that I need to take largely to be able to reach my destination, because the road between me and my destination, my business goal, is kind of, you know, dug up. It's very, very unclear. There's no markers in place. There's no clear markers in place. So therefore, as an employee, as a part of the business ecosystem, do I have the competence to navigate that distance without the markers being there? And therefore, I can only do that if I have a person who can predict and not react. Businesses will now obviously be much more geared up trying to predict such pandemics as today and the consequential impact it has had on business and economy. So it would need people who can do more prediction than reacting to a problem. And you can only do that if you are an, I call it an anchor and not a follower, which is more like somebody who is a leader, not a follower. This leader has nothing to do with designation, seniority, etc. At whatever level you might be in the organization, can you take a lead or do you have to wait for people to tell you what to do and how to do? Can you go forward and suggest with your seniors, your supervisor, this could be the way? Since there are no markers in place, can we try this route? If we try this route, these are the possible pitfalls, or these are the pros and cons. Can you visualize that? Those are competencies and skills that would be in demand, because business would need that more than ever. Now, just to take a pause here, I'll take a pause here because I'll step back and give you an example. I'm a student of physics. My own background is from physics. So I have to bear with me for giving an example which is very physics related, but I will not get into a class of physics, don't worry. You know, you see this picture of all the best of people walking in every single direction, left, right, center, up and down, and diagonal, etc., etc. So that's exactly what we are talking about. There is no sanity, no clarity, no direction as to what's going to happen now. Therefore, is it really all doomsday? If this is kind of a black hole, is there any opportunity how to navigate that black hole? Is there a way in that black hole? Is there a path there? You know, essentially, I say that you should be like a theoretical physicist. What do I mean by that? You know, a theoretical physicist, what he or she does, you know, the universe is pretty much often in chaos as we normally stare at it and understand it or try and understand it. It's a theoretical physicist who can sit down with his pen and paper, by and large, work out, think in a particular manner, work out with mathematical equations how this universe is conducting itself, create some mathematical formula to try and define the rules and the nature of universe, the way it occurs, the way it is, the way it behaves, and so on, and makes certain predictions with those formulae, with those mathematical expressions, which if it is proven to be correct through experiment, that particular theory of the physicist or the mathematical equation becomes a law in science and physics. So therefore, the theoretical physicist can only do it because he keeps exploring, he keeps trying to understand what's there in this mess called the universe. So it's a typical, he's trying to find order amidst what is apparent chaos. And putting not only finding order, putting a mathematical equation to it, trying to make predictions which when proven correct with mathematical experiments, predictive experiments, are accepted as laws of nature. Now, exactly this is what I guess is what our requirement is today, going forward. Therefore, I'll just skip this slide. If you remember this slide we were there, what we are therefore saying is that if we are not saying, obviously, we have to be like great theoretical physicists and all, that's not the point. The point is that we have to think in that way. We have to understand that this is how life shall be going forward. And if we have to be successful, if you have to do well in a post-COVID, post-pandemic world, which is anyways or was anyways having a very VUCA ecosystem even before, because of what we call the Industry Revolution 4, which was happening for the last almost a decade. Industry Revolution 4 is all about, take a pause, is all about the advent of the latest technologies which is changing the face of the world. Few names to give, and I'm aware of it, so I'm not getting into details. It is to do with AI, it is to do with VR and AR, which is virtual and augmented reality, it is to do with robotics, it is to do with IoT, it has to do with 3D printing. We can keep naming it. And students and people of today are fairly aware of, if not the details, the terminologies, I'm sure. So all this over the last decade almost was creating a lot of change, or what triggering a lot of change, a lot of uncertainty and volatility in the business ecosystem. And this pandemic, because it is at global scale, has only accelerated that volatility, that uncertainty, etc. So more the reason why we and I, to be successful in this world, needs to take a step back, and apart from our competence and skills, whatever they be, qualifications, we need to understand what else must we have, what is that delta that will take us through or make us still relevant in the job market. Now, if this was the slide, and there is a word, therefore, what does it mean for all cost. So let's look at an example. Before we do that, this is a quick slide on what are the industries that are likely to be hit by COVID and the ones that are less likely. By the way, please don't take it to be a final list. We can keep debating whether certain industry I see on the left should appear on the right. I'm not going to go into that. But essentially, the main point is, what will happen with these industries which are hit by COVID much more now than before is that they would have staggered hiring. Let's not push it around it. They will probably hire less. Let's go back two slides. He said the business will be under cost pressure. So they will try to do the same job with 10 people, which were being done by 15 people yesterday, if possible. So they will either reduce hiring or they will stagger their hiring. If they are doing 5 hirings a month on an average, they might do 2 a month tomorrow. This is a reality. Does it mean something is very bad? Not necessarily. Just bear with me. But let's understand the reality. They could be that they are paying lesser salary for the same job than they were paying yesterday again because of the same reason. And on the other hand, they will demand productivity from all of us. And productivity as against production. So it is that they will expect that by giving lesser input into the business, which includes salaries of you and I, includes any and many other inputs into the business, they expect higher returns per person. So therefore, as an individual me, do I know how, if I was given 100 output yesterday, can I make it 110 for it as an individual? And if yes, how? And if I can do that, if I'm in my respective role, as the roles may be, then probably I'll be in having an advantage over others as far as the acceptability or requirement of me as an individual is concerned. And last but not the least, there will be fewer fringe benefits. We understand what fringe benefits, all the fancy benefits that the corporate executives, all of us who are used to, etc., will certainly likely to go down. Few of the
Mr. Haldar, I think there are questions. Our audience is already excited and participating with the form of questions. If you could please
go ahead.
Rita?
The first question refers to slide two, when you have talked about people will spend less. And the question is that since we've become a diehard consumer society, would this actually happen to have a severe impact on the industry and the economy?
Jury is out, Britta. I really don't know. I mean, I can't be more honest. I think each of us can make and hazard a guess. My essential point is that certain things are reality, which is not based on interpretation of reality, which is opinion of you and I and anyone, and we're as right or as wrong. It's my take, and I have two perspectives. One is, what is reality is that business will get handled to a significant extent. It already has, and therefore, it will be necessarily under cost pressures. If nothing else, just to pause there a bit, I'll answer this question. Let me just show the slide I'm on right now. It is actually answering or trying to set a context for that. The industry which is less affected, let's look at this. They will continue to do regular hiring. In fact, they may have an accelerated demand of manpower. You never know. So, and there would be need for speed because they will have to do more at less time. And I'll tell you what I mean by that. And but there will be increased competition. Now, it might seem contradictory. Let me close this slide and finish this slide and I'll come back to the question. That's a very important question. There are some industries that I've mentioned on either side. Please don't get into hair splitting of whether the industry should be on this side or that side. That's not the important point. The important point is, we may debate that, but the important point is that certain industry would certainly be more hit. For example, aviation. People, if nothing else, for COVID rules, the airline might have to carry, and this is not only India, we're talking global, including India. Might have to carry less passengers, might have to carry, even if they carry same number of passengers, every passenger may be less, maybe more worried to travel physically. They might try and complete more work online between businesses to business. Travel itself might come down. So there could be an impact on not only aviation, on hospitality, which is hotels, etc., food and beverage, high-end restaurants, etc., etc. Equally, there could be media, banking, health particularly, which is actually, in the last 3 months, the industry that has minted money is some of the health industry, hospitals and private hospitals and all, for good reason. Essential services, wellness business is expected to grow very well because people are wanting to quote-unquote stay well, which is a new business that has emerged over the last one decade. IT-enabled analytics, which are all aware, IoT, AI, I was mentioning about that, AI and machine learning and AR, VR solution, tobacco and alcohol might still do well. So to come back to your question, Vita, the person who's asking this question, a valid question, will consumers stop spending? I think essentially that was the question. If they don't, I think we have been most happy. But should they do? And even if it comes down by 20%, that has a serious impact on business. And if it has an impact on business, it has impact on all of us who are either already in corporate world or are aspiring to be a corporate citizen of tomorrow. And therefore, it's important to plan for that. If it's not required, brilliant. If there is no impact on industry, great. But I'm not so sure that there will be not there will be zero impact on industry because of Industry Revolution 4 and now COVID. It can only grow. It will come down. Brita, any question you want me to take now or I move forward?
Brita, is there any more questions?
Yes, there is. This is from J.P. Rath, where he talks about we have better tools now to deal with VUCA. And though VUCA, we've had that before in businesses, we have better tools now to deal with them. And still better ones are under development, such as analysis of big data and computing power. Coming in another decade is AI. COVID is temporary, 2-3 years. Businesses will need to adapt. So what do you think? How long before the hurricane of VUCA settles down to a normal VUCA?
Two parts. I'm not saying that this discussion that I'm having is only because of COVID. Far from it. I'm saying that COVID has only accelerated the VUCA environment existed because of Industrial Revolution 4, as this gentleman rightly said, that are we better prepared? Of course, that's exactly my point. The newer technologies that are in fact, this present slide, the second and the last line on the right-hand bottom corner is talking about exactly that, IoT, AI, IT-enabled analytics, ML, AR, and VR solutions, etc. These are exactly the ones that are emerging. However, and this is important, that I do not think, and this is one opinion against the other maybe, but my take is that the way the business used to function, A, because of these new technologies that are emerging, and COVID is only an enabler in that whole process, will metamorph itself into doing business in a different way, which would have an impact on, or rather, a way of life as far as tomorrow's corporate citizens are concerned. The way we had our corporate life going, the rules of the game, as we call it, would change for A, the employees, B, the business, C, the consumer, D, any and every other stakeholder. For example, with the advent of latest technologies of AI, et cetera, the worry is, and I, if time permitting, I'll share a few slides on that. It's going to take away a lot of the classical jobs that we have today, which are operational in nature, but new skills and new jobs will emerge. So it's a different world altogether. And that's exactly the point, that yes, it will lend itself to uncertainty over a period of time. COVID is still, I'm not too worried about COVID. It will automatically phase out over the next year and a half too. But what will emerge as a consequence is a slightly different world than we are familiar with today.
There is another question. This is from Neha Arora, who's talking about MSMEs and saying that they have been the worst affected by the recent upheaval, and some of them are on the verge of closing. In the context of MSMEs, how can they adapt to the new normal, taken in the fact that their resources are limited?
It's a very, very difficult question to answer in a very, you know, one line away, since time is at a premium now. But it's a very valid question. It's exactly my point. See, large part of Indian diaspora, the economy of India, in terms of employment, etc., is largely generated by the MSME and SMEs, not by the large corporates. And yes, the government of the day has stepped in trying to provide various relief packages, etc., etc. But the MSME sector will be hit. There is no two ways about it. And how would they navigate this? Can they navigate this? It's not an easy answer, Brita. I'm sorry if I'm unable to give a one-line, you know, one-size-fits-all solution to this. I'll be lying, and if I'm including, I think all of us, including myself, I say, here is this one prescription that an MSME can do. But yes, it is possible to plan something out for an MSME, but it can be very specific to that particular MSME company. What are their current scenarios? How difficult are they? In what industry they are part of? What is the ecosystem in that industry looking like? How to minimize cost and try and optimize revenue? So to be very company and industry specific. Is it possible to be done? Certainly. Will it work? We don't know. We have to, as I said, it's VUCA, but we have to experiment with various efforts and initiatives. But I would not be able to really answer as to there is one line as to two steps that one can take to address all MSME rules in the post-COVID scenario. That's my honest answer. But it can be very company and industry specific. Can it be done? Of course it can be done. But it needs to be deep dived into. I don't think it can be given a superficial answer. It's a deeper problem than that.
Okay. Naveen Verma has actually said what you have already said, which is that the spending power of masses will go down. Then despite all the smart technology, the industry will ultimately not sustain in the absence of money in the hand of consumers. I think that you have already dealt with this particular comment. And would you like to add anything to it? Or is
what you let me move on. But yes, money in the hand, again, as somebody earlier said that VUCA, COVID could be a temporary impact. Yes, temporary in about a couple of years since. It will have a lasting impact over the next year, maybe two. I'm not a medical expert. I can't comment. But that's what I hear and read. However, the impact on the economy will have a trigger effect, a ripple effect. And more so, as I keep saying, because of Industry Revolution 4, the industry was going through a VUCA, and that has only got further jumbled and further accelerated because of this pandemic. But money in the hand of people is a challenge now, and government of the day is doing a lot perhaps, but is that enough? But more than we're not discussing what the government is supposed to do here, what we are discussing is, given that uncertainty, what is it that the employees of tomorrow, would-be employees of tomorrow, corporate citizens of tomorrow, because I understand large part of this this audience here, I'm talking to our student community, so I'm addressing it more to them. The flavor of this session is more directed to them. And therefore, I'm saying that they should better be aware of what is it that will be required of them and what additional skills, if I may say, so beyond their qualifications might come in handy. Going forward, a very important point I wanted to leave as a thought with everybody, you know, I think there will be an organizational shift. It has already happened in many corporates in many parts of the world. In India also in bits and pieces, but it will only now become more and more because of the VUCA, both because of Industrial Revolution 4 and now COVID. See, if you look at this slide, it's a slightly busy slide, but let me explain this. I don't know if you can see the cursor. There is a heading called organization. Britta, is the cursor visible? Called
organization. Yes, it is. Yes, okay, the cursor is visible.
Okay, so we're calling it an organization shift. Let's see what was yesterday's organization looking like. See, typically, you have an MD or a CEO at the top, and there will be departments under him or her, typically production, supply chain, sales, marketing, HR, IT, finance, and etc. You can keep going. See, these are typically structures which we call organization structures. There are departments, and there are then head of departments and teams below, etc. But these org structures have kind of, you know, grown over the years, over the past many decades, globally, and were found to be perfectly fine till now, till a few years back. But then if you look at the structure, essentially, these are silo structure, which mutually exclusive deliverables. What means is that the production person in the factory is supposed to produce, manufacture, and get certain numbers of manufacturing items out per unit time, out of the factory. Similarly, the supply chain person had his or her own deliverables. I'm not saying they are completely divorced from each other, but they are pretty much independently doing their job. So for sales and marketing, they're responsible for marketing and sales or whatever is getting produced. HR is responsible for looking at the organization stability, for looking at the right people, the right skills of people, and so on, like getting the organization ready, keeping it ready all the time. And IT and finance, the same. So please understand, in my view, this structure was designed and got perfected over many decades because they were designed for efficiency and effectiveness. The organization was designed, this kind of a structure, because they were designed for efficiency and effectiveness. And this is fine. Efficiency and effectiveness is fine when the ecosystem is stable with minimal radical shifts. And business models are based on predictable commercial patterns. And this is important. Today, that prediction of what the next 2 years is likely to be, how my market is likely to change as a business, what my ecosystem is likely to be over the next 2 years is very, very difficult, much more difficult, maybe not very difficult, but more difficult than before to predict. In a scenario like that, where there is uncertainty and volatility, this kind of structure might actually be a self-defeating process. So over time, organizations in the last decade or so have shifted. HR has moved to something called a more agile structure, where the lack of structure is the structure. This is not a session to get into what is agile structure and all, but why I wanted to leave this point with students, particularly students of today and would-be corporate citizens of tomorrow, that organizations have already started in large parts of the world and will increasingly do so even in India. Some in India have already moved here, some more will with time soon, that when we have unstable, when we have disruptive forces, when we have unpredictability, we need not a static structure, but a very agile structure, very nebulous structure. And that will give you speed, agility, and adaptability. So please understand, with more than efficiency and effectiveness, an organization must be able to have speed, agility, and adaptability because your external ecosystem is not stable. Because the ecosystem is completely unstable, is kind of morphing, metamorphing all the time, the organization has to keep adjusting its way of doing work in order to survive in that uncertain environment. It's like saying that if I give a cricket example, since we are all in India, the cricket example is the best. If you are starting a one-day match...
You're talking here about agility, which means I believe Mr. Haldar is talking about multitasking, about adaptability.
You're asking me, available?
No, I'm just saying that I think the it was a little disrupted. But please
Okay. So what I meant is that the agile structure is having an org structure where there is no structure is the structure almost. And this is not a session on agile structure, but what is agile structure? It is not as simple as this, but this is just to make people aware. Again, as I said, mostly the students of today who will be citizens, corporate citizens tomorrow, to be aware that these organizations tomorrow over the next decade will start looking very different. That's my take. And because the organization have to have a structure or a way of work which fits into a very VUCA ecosystem. It can't have a very static, fixed structure and way of work because the environment in which it has to operate and be successful is no more static. It's no more. So it has to have a design of structure and way of work which is lending itself to be having speed, having agility, having adaptability. The organization must be extremely adaptable, quickly adjust to changes. Like, for example, this COVID, just to give an example. Many organizations today are not desired, or not ready to figure out what now to do. What is it now? What is it that we can do now? Had there been much more agile structure with preparedness before, they would have been better prepared. But this was an uncalled for, unseen, unpredictable reality, suddenly which kind of was thrown on us by COVID. Forget COVID for a minute. Tomorrow's business environment will be hit by such missiles, not because of health reasons or because of virus, but because of technology reasons. It's already getting hit and will shall get hit more. So how well does a business respond will depend on its agility, its ability to be flexible. And therefore, more flexible structure. An important point I have to make, the last 2 points, particularly for students who will be citizens of tomorrow. I suspect, and people can join issue with me on here, people can debate, no problem, but I suspect increasingly jobs will look like making filmmaking and less like jobs as we understand today. That's my take. What I mean by that is that organizations, and this is over the next decade, 15 years, maybe not immediately, but students of today would have a career over the next 20 years, 25 years, 30 years. So I'm looking at that horizon. And I'm saying that jobs over time will increasingly become like filmmaking. You know, if you know, 70, 80 years back, maybe more, when India started doing films, somewhere in the 20s and 30s, it had a studio system. I don't know, many of those who are students of history might know. They would have established studios. It's almost like an organization where artists were hired and they were employed, they were paid, and they could only be films produced and made by those studios. Today, filmmaking has nothing to do with studio because, or hardly anything to do with studio, but that model is no more viable financially. So we have an independent producer, an independent director, scriptwriter, actor, actresses, and the technicians, and the cameraman, and the music director, and everybody. There are 100 such people who come together to make a film end to end, from scriptwriter to release. And once that film is made and released, the same 100 people go their own different ways and may or may not work together again, the same 100. Some may not, all 100 may not, more likely to be. Or maybe they won't. So it's organizations and jobs of tomorrow is probably over the next 20 years is going to look more like that, because organizations will have to adapt to a far more high-tech, high volatile environment because mostly of technology. COVID is just an incidental point to it. And therefore,
I have a question about the agility to make it easier to understand to myself and to perhaps our younger audience. To be agile would need a person to have a greater basket of knowledge and skills so that they are able to work perhaps in different areas.
Precisely so. And then here, the agile thing, I was talking more about the organization as a whole, the organizational structures which should let, for example, I can be extremely agile as an individual employee.
Yes.
My organization structure is like the previous one, where it forces me to operate within a silo, force fits me to do a particular job and role. No matter how agile I am, I will not be able to demonstrate and give back to the organization as much as I can or could. So the organization on the one hand, employee of course on the other, both must together be agile. Organizational agility comes from its structure and systems and form. And the individual agility, as you rightly said, and if you look at my last sentence here, last line, exactly what I have said. See, more than a career, students of tomorrow, please remember that it's your skills that will be in demand. So for example, if Amitabh Bachchan is and was the superstar and the megastar in the 70s, he still retains his primacy at 75 plus age, is probably because of what he brings to the table. Age independent. So when he was 25 or 35, he was at the top of the world and probably still is, in his ability to give what the film industry demands and the film fraternity wants. So therefore, if you and I have the skills which need to flex and change with time, skills can't be any more static. That will make your relevance stay in the job market for the next 20 years, rather than don't look for careers, because career concept is gone. Today I join as an executive, 10 years from now I'll be a manager, 10 years hence a head of department. That vertical growth concept is likely to be not there. It's already going away and will only become much more as we move forward. What will however remain is that, are you having the right skills for the environment of that point? And if you have, you are home and dry. And I'll talk about briefly what are some of the skills that you can look at beyond your by no means am I saying that your basic qualification is not required. I'm not saying that. Please get it very clear that your basic qualification, quote unquote, the educational degrees that you might be taking, including your management qualifications, if any, are important. They are not enough anymore, is my point. And there are skills that you can take in depending on what is your area of interest and what the job market is having demand for. And it is not difficult to kind of collect that and have those skills over time and stay relevant therefore. Let's look at some of those possibilities. Therefore, my next slide is all about what are the skills that are likely to be in demand in this whole VUCA scenario. And this is only indicated list. Please don't take it as the exhaustive list. Again, for want of time, I'm sticking to few and not many. But this is only indicative. Some of them you are aware of. I'm calling it tech savviness. You can call it what you like. Forget the details. That's not important. Digital transformation is already there. And because of now COVID, everything and everybody is trying to go online to survive, and businesses will have to move online. So there is no way, two ways about it. So, and somebody mentioned a while back, as Brita was saying, that artificial intelligence, big data is the order of the day. I'm not getting into what is AI, what is big data. I don't have time for that. But what is important here is the right-hand bottom line. And that's what I want to draw your focus on. Tech savviness is a skill issue. You can train yourself for that. And by that, I don't mean you have to become a super expert in artificial intelligence or big data. No. You can even get what I call certification skills, certification courses, which are few months, that you can do online, that is possible to be done online, often free. There are many top universities in the world which offer you free courses like that. And I'm forgetting those sites, often I don't recall. But there are those sites, for example, Stanford, I'm sure, offers such skills almost free of cost, some of them. So you have to do a little bit of research. Many of you would have been locked at home because of this lockdown in the last 2 months. Just to pause and give an interesting example, I don't know how many of you students I'm addressing this to took advantage of this two months, quote unquote, almost a holiday, almost, and could actually, you know, explore where else to skill yourself apart from your MBAs, etc., online, to become that much more relevant in the job market and have that extra skill over the other contender, the competition, who's also applying for the same job. And this is what I was talking about, data about individual agility. Did I make use of these 2 months? Am I aware of what's happening around me? Do I take an interest? And see, 25 years back when I started my career, unfortunately, internet, etc., was not there, and it was not so easy. But today it is far more easy thanks to Google Baba. You can goddamn Google anything. You can ask Google, what is my name, and it will tell you what is your name also. So, in fact, I asked a question in a different presentation. I was looking at the data, just to take a second's digression, and the data says some nonsense, some 38, 40 billion queries are posted on Google. Look at the staggering figure, some 30, 40 billion, if I remember. And it is always questions being asked to Google globally. And there is this new term that has come up, many of you might know it, it's called BG. We had BC and AD before Christ and after the birth of Christ. Now we have BG and AG. So these 40 million queries that go to Google today, one was wondering, where were these queries asked BG before Google 20 years back when Google didn't exist? And there's the life before Google and life today after Google. But it's more BG and AG. But having said that, that's on a lighter note, that having this a new terminology in the offing, BG and AG, more than BC and AD, Brita, it has become more famous now. But for generations of today.
It's difficult to imagine life in AG now.
I can't imagine it myself, though I have grown up in the 80s, and I can't. And I survived. I'm sure Brita and maybe Party, you also prefer, but students of today without their smartphone can't live life. So that's how, and I have worked in telecom industry for an IT for almost large part of my career. And I have seen that transition from 2000, largely, year 2000 to say 2015, how that transit, including India, and of course abroad. So coming back, I'm saying it is possible to skill yourself. It's possible to train yourself. And these I'm talking about, even certification courses would help. It will give you a reasonable hang of what to do with these skills. Because tomorrow, please understand, organization that you will go to, many of them would employ these technologies. So if you do not know how to use those technologies, you will be at a disadvantage. So that's important to do it. Look at some of the others. Oh, I'll give you a quick example before I go to that. Some data on the left-hand side, which I'll not read out. So is it possible if you can read it? Can you tell me which, I'm naming an organization, this is an organization. Can somebody guess what it is? And answers can come to Brita on the screen. I'll give a minute for answers to come. This is an organization. I'm asking you to guess this organization. It's very well known, so it's not that something very difficult. But and in fact, one or two data is a giveaway, is a straight giveaway, but still.
Is it Nokia? Is it Nokia?
Yeah, absolutely, it is. So I don't know if the others can see or hear, but let me move on. We are talking about Nokia, but look at the change. Somewhere in 2003-04, All India, it had 50%, All India, sorry, globally, it had 50% of the market share. It's unimaginable as far as a product is concerned. And yet, 3-4 years from then, it was facing bankruptcy. And why did it happen? What happened? What did go? Did Nokia have incapable executives? Certainly not. Did they have customers who suddenly became unhappy with their product? Certainly not. Till yesterday, the same me who was happily using a Nokia phone, if I'd asked this question 15 years back in India or world, 80% people would say they are using Nokia. If I ask this question today, it will be less than 5%. So what happened? The tragedy is, and this is what I call about the impact of VUCA and why individual and organization must remain agile, is that Nokia is a, and there are hundreds of such examples, Nokia is just one, were not agile enough. See, please understand, their product was still the best. And yet, something came along in 2007-8. and the picture on your right tells you what it is.
Yes, Apple. Yes.
And yeah, it's iPhone which was launched. What was it? It was very different from a routine phone that you and I and the whole world was used to. And because it offered me something, so many other features and benefits and facilities that the classical Nokia phone was not, or classical Symbian platform phones were not able to provide, the whole world 50% global customer base, while they were still happy with Nokia, perfectly fine. Not that the product suffered, not that Nokia customer service went down the drain, no. En masse, overnight, over the next 2-3 years, shifted to this new brand called iPhone or equivalent phones on the Android platform without Nokia going down on its efficiency or effectiveness. So that's the point, that you can still be as effective, as efficient, and still find yourself thrown out.
I think the word here is innovation, right? I mean, if I have understood it correctly.
Precisely. You're ahead of me.
Flexible and agile organization, the nascent market there is the startups and the innovation, the kind of paradigm shift in creative thinking that they are bringing to the table.
Precisely. You are ahead of me, absolutely. I have it perfectly correct. You are bang on, you're spot on. And therefore, I'm saying that 2013-14, this organization was dead, taken over by Microsoft, etc. And reason was this gentleman on the right. And we all know him. He's famously known for his innovation. Now, again, forget the what is written on the left hand side. This skill, I call it. Now, let's not get split hairs on between skills and competency here. In HR terminology, we have a difference, but I'm not getting there for this session. Let's look at each other as interchangeably. Creativity and innovation is another important competence and skill. Call it what you like. That will be required by all of us, more so because it's a VUCA, and because it is VUCA, because it is not clear what the world and navigation markers shall be like, more the reason why innovation is required. It's like that theoretical physicist I was talking about. When he sits down, he's trying to make sense out of this universe. He has no reference frame. He doesn't have a textbook to fall back on. So he has to figure out from entirely his understanding of what he sees around, tries to put a mathematical formula around it and come up with certain conclusions, which is completely a classical example of innovation. The real business impact of innovation, Steve Jobs is one of the best. And it is essentially, and I like to focus you on the bottom right corner, it is mostly a right brain capability that we have. And we, again, this is not a session for that, but many of us might know the human brain has mostly two parts. We call it the left and right brain. And the left brain, for those who might not know, just a superficial statement, this is not, I'm not getting into depth of it, is primarily, the left half of the brain is primarily designed to help us become logical, good with numbers, rational, etc., etc. Whereas the right half of my brain is, if developed, will develop certain other competencies in me or certain other traits in me, one of them being innovation. Usually this is not taught in a school or a college curriculum, unfortunately, but innovation. Yes.
If you come to think of it, in our schools and colleges, students are required to learn what is in their textbooks and more or less regurgitate that for the exams. They are not encouraged at all to think for themselves.
Precisely, and that's the most unfortunate part of, and I keep talking about this multiple seminars that I do with the educators and the academics here, as to the need to adapt and change the academic curricula, because we are outdated, unfortunately. I'm talking about the larger academic curricula in the schools and colleges, and not designed to cater to the needs of tomorrow. So anyways, you are also right, Brita, and it's the child in us which needs to survive. The child has that, when he or she is born, the child retains that innovation. He will go and inquire about everything, and yet even I as adults try and stop him or her at home and at school and college. It's the unfortunate part.
Okay, and we have another question which is pertinent to innovation, which says that, you know, this ability to think differently, to see things differently, the training, but not the training required for it, but the opening up of minds required for it, isn't this going to increase the disparity which already exists in India? Where do the masses in India fit in with this whole concept of innovation and the need for it? What is required by us?
I'm sorry, what is? Sorry, Greta, what was the last part of your question?
The last part of his question was, what innovations are required by us to address the disparity that will be created? The disparity will be greater than before, because innovation or the open way of thinking is not a skill which is inculcated in the majority of us.
While my immediate answer is that, will the disparity increase? I don't know. I'm not a sociologist. What I don't know, I admit upfront. I really can't comment. I can hazard a guess at best. That's not my specialization. So I think sociologists and economists would be in a better position to really answer that. It's an important question. But I will be again saying that I don't have the real answer. I'm not an authority on that. I can only give my intelligent response, common sense response, which is, will disparity grow? Probably yes. But do I have a choice? The answer is no. Now, the reason I say this is because whether we like it or not, technology march shall move on. Will disparity grow? My humble submission is, in the apparent sense it might, but in the real sense it actually may not. It can actually, I take an opposite view, it can actually reduce disparity, but that's my take. I'll tell you what, people have often been worried that technology often takes away jobs. This has been a worry throughout, and I talk about it a little later in the slide, so I'll park this for the moment and I'll come back to this, Greta, just allow me.
Great.
But essentially, coming back, innovation is the key, and it's possible to train yourself a bit also on innovation and creativity. It is possible. So something that I wanted to leave with all of you. I'll deal with this a little later also. Data literacy is something I think we all understand. It's a skill issue about big data, about how to manage. I'm not saying you have to know everything that I'm talking about. I'm saying decide what is your area of interest. Each of these would have job relevance even in a post-COVID environment over the next decade, two decades. Make a choice that you would like to choose depending on your preference, but make a choice. And please train yourself. These are trainable skills. And I'm not saying get into another two-year course. If you want and if you can do it, great. Even if you can't post your MBA or during your MBA, you can take online courses and they will at least give you that delta edge. It's like saying, I'm knowing how to operate a laptop and a PC and use Microsoft Office. To give a very stupid example, I have that skill because every organization I go to today would require me to use a laptop or a PC and do my work using MS Office platform. So I better skill myself. It's the same example. You need to look at it from that angle. Do I need to do all this? No. So at least train yourself in areas that you find interesting or relevant for you. Data literacy is another big area that will have and continue to have relevance over the next decade. Digital skills, of course, and some of them are here, coding, web development. These are all possibilities. Marketing, communication for online. This is yet in its nascent stage in India, hardly. Please don't mistake this for online sales that you find. I'm not talking about digital. Marketing communication is a different ballgame by itself. Digital marketing is still in its nascency in India. But now with this technology revolution for, and more so by COVID, because of COVID, organizations will invest more in this, and for two reasons. One, it's more cost effective, but bigger reason, it will give a good prevention from tomorrow's possible COVID equivalent uncertainties. Because today, because of lockdown, physical sales models were ineffective. They were all locked out. Online sales was the only one that was working, largely. So organizations, to ensure their revenue, would shift their business or try to shift their business on a digital platform beyond just online sales and look at the whole go-to-market model from an online perspective as an equivalent, if not over time, better than their offline model. So this is a next 5 to 10 year story for sure. And therefore, because everything is going largely online, HR analytics performance and platform and tools and financial analytics platforms, skills, depending on if you are a finance person by background, a HR person, sales marketing by your MBA qualification, decide what you want to do, but decide one of this. And if you can keep the online business running and thriving during future crisis of any kind, then you are a must hire for the organization. If you can do these, some of these, all of these, few of these, one of these, then the organizations would need that skill that you bring to the table beyond your management qualifications. So that is important. Last, but let me take another one. I was talking about this, you know, the left and right brain. And it's important to have what is called emotional intelligence measured through what is called EQ, emotional quotient. Like you have IQ, which is a measure. Earlier it used to be thought, you know, that IQ is a measure of the whole brain. Later it has been found it's not true. And IQ measures your left half of the brain, which I was talking about. The right half measure is not given by EQ. So if you have a well-developed whole brain, then you need a score of IQ plus EQ. So what does the right brain really look at? Right brain looks at your creativity, your ability to be creative, your ability to be innovative, your ability to be sensitive, your ability to be emotional, and all those humane and human qualities. And those will become very important in the businesses of tomorrow, not because you have to be sympathetic to people only. No, not because of that. It's because of your ability to sense, to innovate, sense what might happen, sense the route when there are new markers, be able to therefore innovate. It took Steve Jobs, nobody told Steve Jobs that an iPhone could come when the phones of Nokia were, and many others of large brands were doing so well. It took his innovative mind to think beyond the normal, think out what we call very popularly out of the box. But thinking out of the box is not a chance factor. It's a trained skill issue. And one can train oneself to do that, at least do it better than when I'm not trained. Somebody with developed or trained design thinking skills would be in higher demand, or these skills shall have more demand over the next decade, now and over the next decade and more, as we go along. So I'm just trying to highlight, because of paucity of time, the areas that would have demand. I am unfortunately not having time to deep dive into any one of them, but this is just to give you a perspective and an overview for now. Just to take a different angle, I don't know how many of you know this, I have taken this from data that I had on the net, and I want to share this with you. Can you read this?
Brita, parking lot attendance, yes. Right?
Sorry?
Parking
lot. No, below that, at the bottom.
60% of the best jobs, yeah, of next decade.
This is hardcore data. This is hardcore. This is hardcore data, research data, global data, not India. Now, this is not only India, this is world, but because India and world are integrated, it's a globalized economy, pretty much, if not 60, it will be 40% in India maybe, I don't know, but pretty much similar. But it is not a statement that is made in air. There is a reason why that statement is made. And more important, if this is so, I mean, let's not argue whether it is 60, it can be 50, it can be 65, it can be 45. The essential point is a large number of jobs that will actually have high demand do not exist today. They are not there as a job today.
This is very exciting, I think, for the new students and the younger lot who are going to start looking for jobs. This is so exciting.
Precisely. So I'm saying, while there is COVID and everything, there is still hope in hell. As long as I am ready to skill myself for that tomorrow, whatever is going to be in demand tomorrow. And I'm ready, and these skilling are not high tech, high funda, high length, high long courses, you know, etc., something over the top. No. There are very sharp, precise courses, certification courses available. All I'm saying is, please explore, you know, it is there, and figure out what is the best for you. Talk to your mentors if you have any, to your faculty members, take their help, to your seniors, to your alumni, to all the other industry experts, and decide what you think is best or optimal for you. But do that is what my submission is. Let's move on. When I say this, I'll also explain what are some of why we say this. Also, again, for the students of today, in the past, careers were stable, linear, and singular. You join today, you grow over time. All of us, even I did it. Over the last 25, 27 years that I've been working, people choose one path and pursue it over the course of their lives from college to retirement. In the same organization, in two, three different organizations, whatever. But now the future might actually be the opposite, which I mentioned a while back. We become like filmmaking. your skills will be in demand. You will be required, if you are having the skill, if you are the Sachin Tendulkar or the Amitabh Bachchan, you will always be in demand. I'm not saying all of us can be Amitabh Bachchan. No, that will be unreal. But even if you can be somebody who brings some differential skill to the table, you shall be home and dry. Some unique skill to the table, which is in demand at a particular point in time by business, then you are home and dry. All I need to do is understand what that skill is and keep upskilling and reskilling myself. And mind you, no one skill is permanent in the near future. What you skill yourself today with, you might have to again reskill with something else 5 years down the line. So continuously reskilling yourself is the mantra going forward over the next 20 years, for sure. Therefore, I'll skip this, it's not so important. I want to give you a story here. Now, and the picture I picked up from the net, of course, this is, I think, New York. And what do you see? And since I can't interact with the actual audience there on Facebook, this is New York, most likely. And I think what we see is, like we see a traffic jam of cars today, we are traffic jam of horses and carriages that we see. Now, interestingly, Brita, is this visible?
Can you see? Yes, absolutely.
Okay. I don't know if Brita is there.
No, I haven't. I have been.
Oh. Okay.
It's extremely interesting to watch this. You know, you just replace that with cars, and we probably
Is it a procession?
No, this is probably New York. I picked up this picture from
just
the net.
Date
is given by me based on the data I picked up. This is probably New York in that time mentioned, 1895 to about 100 plus years back. And look at the traffic jam, but it is not of cars. It's of horses and carriages, because people used at that point in time. Now, this is a typical advertisement when the first, those days, 1901-2, those days when the motor car of that time first came about in the year 1900. And price was $1,000 at that point in time. So let's not discuss that, because, but this is what a typical ad, look at the heading. Important point, dispense with a horse. Reason I'm sharing this with you is this is a reality that has continued from ages and shall continue tomorrow. So students of today need not worry that their jobs will go away, because it's a continuum that's been happening throughout. What is important is that you have to reskill yourself. So let me give an example. If I have to dispense with a horse, by the way, in 1901-2, it was this one car, one of the first cars that came out from Ford, as many of you know. And 1915, this is Ford, the factory production line of Ford, were coming out with 1 million cars. This is 1915, 15 odd years, hence, 1 million cars. So look at the shift in customer demand from what was there 20 years back, 20 years, 1895 to 1900. This is what the reality was. What do you think the reality would be 20 years hence in 1915? 1 million car on the road, 1 millionth car. If that be the reality in these 20 years from 1895 to 1915, what will happen to this gentleman and his job? Is he there anymore? Is his job there anymore?
He better learn to drive.
Yeah, exactly. His job as a horse carriage driver, if I may call it that, I don't know what is it called exactly, is no more there. Coachman. Yeah, right. Thank you, Brita. Coachman. So it's gone. However, look at this gentleman. It's gone. That job doesn't exist. But if they decide to reskill themselves, as you rightly said, Brita, and learn to drive, that's the point, essential point I'm trying to make. They are still employed. They are still employable. Why? Because now we have 1 million cars on the road. There's enough jobs. Provided I am willing to adapt. Some slides before I mentioned adaptation and agility. Do I have the adaptability and agility to adapt to the new requirement is what is the ask from all of us. If I can do that, I'm home and dry. Therefore, and this is not the end, therefore, a 1915 data, and I found this interesting, so I'm sharing it. This was the ratio. there were some 26 plus million horses, 100 plus million humans, blah, blah, 1 million cars in 1915. What career advice would you give this gentleman? On the right hand side, the gentleman's picture.
Learn to drive.
Precisely. Well, exactly, I think the point I'm trying to make now, hold on. That also is, let's look at the next slide. Here is 2016. We are now having driverless cars. There are 5 million jobs as drivers worldwide. What career advice will you give him? Now we have driverless.
He had to reinvent himself.
Precisely. If he doesn't realize that his job today or tomorrow, it's a matter of time, will slowly go down. If there were 100 driver vacancies today, it will become 90 tomorrow, 80 day after, and so on, and finally become very few. If I do not realize that, then I can't blame the system. It's for me to be able to become from that horse coachman to a driver. From today, a driver to, if tomorrow I have driverless cars coming, and it is coming because of AI, it is pretty much there. It's no more a science fiction, it's already reality. The question of scalability is only there. So I need to be able to do that quickly and fast. A World Economic Report, and this is my last slide, I'll leave you with this. A World Economic
Report. Just before you carry on, Ashish Mitra, a professor from ISBM Kolkata, has commented, and very rightly, that jobs just don't go away. They are transformed. So therefore, you develop skills that will allow you to keep pace with the transformation.
Can't agree more. That's the whole essential point. And all I'm trying to say, there is a lot of doomsday sayers in the world, in the environment, they saying jobs will go, this will happen, that will happen, COVID, pandemic, A, B, C, D. I'm saying, yes, certain jobs will go, for sure. But that doesn't mean jobs will go. If I am ready to adapt and if I am agile, and if the organization as a whole is agile, that is even more important. This is just not for the individuals and the student. It is for the entire organization. They better also realize that, for example, insurance companies, that business is likely to find itself over time gone, insurance industry, because if you have driverless cars and buses and commuters over the next 20 years, what do you insure? Just as an example. So if the industry and the organization also doesn't matter more, it will go the Nokia way. So it is important for both the organization. That's why a few slides back I said that agile structure is important both from the organization perspective and certainly also from the individual perspective.
A professor, Sharmila Sinha, has pointed out that jugaad amongst the slightly less economic...
Indian masses, I call it Indian jugaad.
Yes. It is actually a huge example of innovation and the willing to use your resources to the best ability.
I can't agree more. Thank you for that wonderful example. And I don't know the gentleman, but with permission, I'll use it in my subsequent.
No, Professor Sharmila Sinha.
Okay, I can't speak to her directly here, but with permission, I'll use this example in my subsequent sessions, and I can't give copyright. Because it's a lovely example, because it's very relevant and very topical. India is a classical example of awesome innovation, and you see it every day on the roadsides if I keep my ears and eye open. Indian jugaad system is an awesome example of what human mind and innovation can do, not at a mega level, but even at a micro level. And that's a beautiful example. Thank you very much for that. Moving on, and by the way, here we are talking about 5 million plus jobs. By the way, here, because of COVID and all, already people are worried what will happen to the Uber drivers and all, because people are losing their jobs and so on and so forth. But if I am able to reskill and learn, I'm good to go. A World Economic Forum report says that in the future, this is not COVID specific, but in the next decade, because of technology revolution, what are the skills that you have that are likely to remain relevant? And by the way, the disruption is caused by all this. Why are we talking about disruption? And all these are reasons. Genetics, biotechnology, nanotechnology, and the rest are self-explanatory. For those who are interested, a two-minute digression, not digression actually, before we started the session, I was sharing this information with Brita. I don't know how many of you are aware of it. This genetics, the first thing on the top reminds me, there is this research that has been done, and I'm forgetting the name of the two scientists. It's available on public domain. Any one of you can go and check. When we talk about disruption and we talk about change, I'll give you the most extreme example of change that is staring us in the face. I don't know how many of us are actually talking about it or even aware of it. There are two gentlemen, two researchers, they have done a research to figure out why you and I, human beings, why do we age? The typical aging symptoms, like we have white hair or we have less hair like me or no hair like me, or for example, we have wrinkled skins, we have the biology of the body going down, or the organs of my body becoming less immune, etc., etc., the typical signs of aging, and therefore finally I and you die. Now, this research, they have already been able to identify the cause of aging. It's a particular gene of a human body, a tail part of the gene which is called telomeron. And they have been able to not only identify the telomeron, if I'm not mistaken, as I've been told, they have been able to experiment if they can re-engineer, and I use the word again, re-engineer the telomeron so that people don't age, and lo and behold, therefore they don't die. It's not science fiction, it's already there. Experiment is already happening for, I think, two or three individuals, and if my memory serves me right, they have been able to not stop death yet, but they have been able to reverse aging by 50 years with those two or three gentlemen, which means that if they were 40, it's not that they have been brought back to 25, but they have stopped aging for the next 15 years. So for the next 15 years, they will remain 40. This is not science fiction. This is already here and now, already done. These two gentlemen scientists have said that by 2045, which is 25 years from now, people will stop dying. It may sound fantastic, absurd, impossible, abnormal, call it what you like, but that is technology for us. Whether we like it or not, 2045 can be 2055, I don't know. But those who are interested, please type death of death on your Google and you will find it. It's called death of death. There is no more death. And you will find the details. But the point I'm making is disruption to that extent. Therefore, some realities. Robots, which we all know, 5 million jobs. By this year, this is a past study, globally will go. Don't worry whether 2020 we did have 5 million jobs going or not. If not 2020, 2022, 5 million will go. But again, I'm saying, please remember, it is not going to take away jobs, as somebody rightly said. It is going to transform the jobs to something else, from the horse coachman to the driver. So these kind of data you keep coming across, don't get too hassled by it. Just remember that you need to keep yourself skilled for the tomorrow. And I'll skip these details, but I think Britta, I'm running out of time. So if I'm not mistaken, am I overshooting time, Britta?
No, you carry on. It's okay. It's very, very interesting.
Okay. So these are, between 2018 to 2020, I'll request you to focus on the right-hand side, there, robotics, autonomous transportation, artificial intelligence, and material and biotechnology, blah, blah, blah. And finally, not the least, we have COVID, which has only accelerated the whole cycle. It is not in itself a change, but it has only accelerated the thinking of organizations and the world to take a fast forward step so that tomorrow, if I'm faced with this again, I'm better prepared. I'm using technology to prevent myself from getting affected as well or as worse as I was this time. These are some of the self-explanatory topics, but what is important, I want to stop is, look at this, and I think this is where I shall conclude. Look at this sequence, and that's important. This is a global data from World Economic Forum. This is researched data, so it is not something, somebody's opinion, not my opinion. I would want you to pause and look at the sequence between 2015 and 2020. Look at the top five, forget the rest. What do you see as a change in the top five? You typically find the right brain I was talking about, those competencies are gaining momentum. They are becoming more important from all of us. Complex problem solving skills, where there are no markers, can I navigate? Critical thinking, design thinking, creativity, people management, which is not a learned skill by by intelligence and rationality. It's a sensitivity and creativity issue. Being able to coordinate, emotional intelligence. Look at all these. None of these are left brain competencies. All of these are right brain issues. Almost all, if not all 10. The last one is very important, cognitive flexibility. What it means is, can I understand what's next? Can I have the cognition, the ability to be able to predict and therefore flex myself, adapt, change myself accordingly? Do I, as a horse coachman, realize in 1895 that 15 years from now, this job is no more there? At 1895, there was no such signal. The first car was hardly getting manufactured. So do I really have the ability, cognitive ability, to think 15 years hence and imagine a world where horses and carriages are gone and only drivers and cars exist? It's not easy, trust me. So therefore, this is a skill. Hence, it's a skill. It's not that everybody will have it. So problem solving, critical thinking, creativity, this is a list of skills that shall be in demand in the business ecosystem because of technology revolution. This is over and above your critical skills of qualifications that you already have or are getting in your current education system, which is important. But please remember, one on the left-hand side is of mission critical importance. And it is possible. The best part is all these are trainable skills. You are, of course, people might argue that you are born with these, you some have it, some don't have it. It's not necessarily true. It's possible to train yourself to a certain extent on these, to a great extent on few. So all you need to do is just do some research, find your right resources who can help you do this. Anyone interested to interact with your campus or through your campus with me or with me directly, feel free to do that. I'm available. My contact details are there with your campus. Or otherwise, and you can find me on LinkedIn or Facebook, whatever, that you can connect with me or you can connect me through your campus, but with anybody else for that matter, who you think can help you. But please take this as a indicative list. And this list of 10 on the left-hand side, in the next 5 years, will undergo a shift again. So keeping track of what's going to happen is important. Quickly, I'll skip. These are the various technologies that will have. So it's a busy slide, the 30 technologies of the next decade. Look at the heading at the bottom. But I'll not waste your time with this because that's too busy a slide. What is important here is 2025, and this is what my last, again, a 2025 prediction by World Economic Forum. What will go up and what might come down. Skills that will have more and more demand and skills that will have lesser job requirement, lesser demand. Interestingly, our education system, as Beta was mentioning sometime back, a school and college gears us to have memory, good memory. You are required to memorize and reproduce in exams. Unfortunately, that's not what will be in demand. Look at the right-hand side. Memory and verbal and spatial abilities will slowly go down. Because memory is good when you have a stable, when 2 plus 2 always make a 4, it's good to remember in memory that 2 plus 2 make a 4. In a VUCA environment, 2 plus 2 may not always make a 4. Therefore, if you only remember it makes a 4, you are not the right person in my company. You must be able to realize it can be 2 plus 2 can become a 3 or can become a 5, for example. So memory can actually be a disadvantage. So, and last, my last statement before I conclude, somebody was asking me, another student in a different environment, management school, that, you know what, you know, we are freshers. So, as it is, jobs might go down because of COVID, etc., at least in the immediate future. So do we at all? How do we compete with those who have more experience than us? My simple response to you is, please remember that over the next 5 years, you and let's say me, with 25 plus years of experience, please understand we are on the same boat. And I'll tell you why. My 25 years of experience and yours 0 year of experience are of the same value today. Reason being that, and shall be so over time, because we're on the same starting line. Because the 25 plus years of experience that I have may not be very relevant in tomorrow's job ecosystem. It's like that horse coachman who knew how to drive that horse coach very, very well. He's one of the best. But it is of less value or zero value when you're asking him to drive a car. So somebody who did not know how to have that coachman skill, never had that coachman skills, started learning how to drive, has zero experience on the coachman skill, and the coachman skill, he's having 30 years of experience, he's actually equal when it comes to driving a car. So please understand that as far as the new landscape is concerned, whether you are a fresher or you are a veteran, you're on the same starting line. So it's not all a bad story. Thank you very much for the moment.
Well, I won't allow you to run away.
No, please.
I have just two questions to ask you.
Sure.
Would you like to stop sharing your screen? Yeah, that's it. You know, I sort of imagine the managers in a line singing, "What's the buzz? Tell me what is happening." Now, how can managers deal with VUCA and the uncertainty that there is associated with it and use it to their advantage and to the company's advantage?
As I said, throughout, I have a very simple answer to it. Become aware of what the VUCA environment is like overall in your industry and in your organization. B, if depending on at what level you are, I don't know, if you are a part of the top management, influence the strategy level of the top management to adapt as a business. B, train your, most important, this is most important, no matter at what level you are, train yourself with the right skills to manage this VUCA environment. Because as I said, that depending on your industry and your company, what is that new skill that you need? You need to fathom, because it's not one size fit all. What might be important as a new skill in an IT or a tech world environment or a tech industry may not be so in a manufacturing industry. So what is it that is relevant in your industry that you need to acquire, A, as an individual, B, as an organization, is something that you need to figure out and therefore influence your system, organization, or at least talk about it internally. You're not senior enough to influence it, but start talking about it, that this is important, but support it with data. Don't just talk about it. My humble submission is, if you have a point of view, I'm sure it should be backed up by solid data, because then people take you seriously. Otherwise, it's just one opinion, however correct, versus another.
Last question, how will companies balance stability with dynamics in the new norm? You want stability.
I have this ill reputation, if I may say so, in the corporate world, for being too much of a maverick for comfort. And I must confess, I am much too much of a maverick. My sense is that you should let go of stability. Because if time is no more there, and I don't mean by that it become chaotic by design. I don't mean that. What I mean that by that is that if I have to stay caged in my mind, not in my action, in my mind, that I need to retain my stability and yet become dynamic, you will end up being nowhere. That's my take. In an organization, beyond the point, at an organization level, you must have a leap of faith. When Steve Jobs, and you look at history of corporate successes, they have all been breakaway innovations. They have, if you do routine activities, continue to do routine activities in the name of staying stable, and do incremental creative activities, thinking that I am being creative to adapt myself to the world tomorrow, I think, in my personal humble opinion, you're fooling yourself. Then you become the Nokia. They kept improving their existing handset, bringing newer models, and in 3 years, from a global number one, they were nowhere. Because somebody else took a leap of faith. You look at and brought in something completely different. You look at any and many product categories in the world that have died, and all died not because somebody brought in an incrementally better solution, because somebody brought in a completely revolution into the same space, a complete revolution. So there they did it. Steve Jobs did not do it because it was a VUCA environment in his time. He did it because he wanted to. That's even more risky. Everything was going fine, stable. He could have brought in a similar phone, tried to make it better than the Nokia. I'm giving cell phone as an example. There are hundreds of other industry examples. Yet he chose to make that leap of faith, and the results are for us to see. So here and now, I think the next 10 years, even if you don't want, the environment will force us to make that leap of faith if I have to survive, because the environment is no more static. So that's my, it may or may not appeal to everybody, this opinion, but that's my honest opinion. It's open to debate maybe, but that's what my response is.
Thank you, Shobhita. You know, I am really loath to end this session because it has been so very, very...
I can go on, but I'm sure your people will run over you. They have been having enough of me.
No, it's really been interesting. It has really opened up and shown us the possibilities of the future. And especially for the young people, it has shown them that there is things for them to do, things for them to learn, and that the world is waiting for them. Thank you
so much. Thank you so much, Britta. It's been a pleasure. And thank you, everybody who had the patience to listen to this. Thank you very much, and maybe see you later. All the best.
And we thank all our viewers too, and to Abhirupa, who so very well did her job as a moderator, but has had to leave now because of a power cut. We live in Calcutta, and life is so.
Thank you. No problem. Thank you very much, Britta. Thanks for all the help. Thank you very much. Goodbye.